Well, let me just tell you that we're getting ready for Wednesday night. We're going to go into the service, and I'm telling you, the Wednesday night's attendance have been great. You've been great to be right there. And tonight, we continue the study of angels. Angels. This is a season in which angels are activated. The angel is coming. Your angel. My angel. We're excited when we begin to study the Word and find out that on Easter Passover weekend, the angel is dispatched. It's a new season. It's an opportunity. And tonight, I cannot wait. I cannot wait to tell you about your angel. The assignment, the agenda in which God is preparing your angel right now. But God is a God of timing. God is a God of order. And in fact, He's a God in which has put three specific dates of the year in order: Passover, Pentecost, and Atonement. So in the next few days, it's going to be Passover. And I'm excited about that. I'm so excited about that. So we're going to go into the service. We're going to worship. We're going to pray for you. But now let me just say something else that happens. I think we got about, three or four more Wednesday nights until Easter. Our cross comes down, and it only comes down on Wednesday night. We don't do this on Sunday. So tonight the cross is going to come down. This is when we go into prayer. I would like for you to pray. When you see the cross coming down, just begin to pray. We're going to go into like a prayer meeting. I'm going to take your requests. And by the way, keep giving your requests. Every week you can put as many requests on the cross. And you email the request, or you communicate with the host, and we will get your request. I personally am nailing, you'll see in a few minutes as we go on the service, I'm nailing your request, your petition on the cross. That cross is filling up, and we are praying for everyone that is on that cross. If you know someone's name that needs to be on that cross, get their name on the cross. I'm so excited about lowering the cross. It's only done in the season of Lent. You'll see the purple fall. And as we go into prayer, and as I nail the request on the cross, we're going to go into prayer time, and we're going to pray for you. Deliverance, healings, miracles. And then the angel that's coming and teaching on what's getting ready to happen to you in this season. So let's go into the service. We're going to do some worship. The cross is coming down. We're going to pray. Then your word about your angel and what that angel is going to do in your life. Let's go into the service now on this big Wednesday night.
I will crush these supports. Thank you, Lord.
Resurrecting.
was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has
but the blood of Jesus. thank you, Lord, for every name, every need. Regardless of how many, Lord, times I put my card or someone else, Lord, would just believe in this Lent season, God, miracles are going to happen, and they're already happening. But Lord, we're believing that in the name of Jesus, that in the name of Jesus, that every need, that every miracle, that every name, every circumstance is going to be met by prayer and asking you, Lord, to touch them. So now let us open it up for those watching, those in the auditorium. Sit with a prayerful heart. Sit on the edge of your seat. If you have your card, pass it to the nearest aisle. For you that are watching, you can tell the host your name. And then everybody in this place, let's turn this into a prayer meeting. You could just, right where you are, standing, sitting, kneeling, wherever you feel comfortable. And we begin to pray. Just begin to pray. Learn to take time to pray. And just begin to pray for other people. Just begin to pray for everything that you can think of about, Lord, touch these needs in the name of Jesus. So pass your cards to the nearest aisle. They're going to bring them. I'm going to nail them to the cross in Jesus' name. Amen.
In Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
He's never let me down. Faithful through generation. So I wouldn't be held down. He won't.
Help me pray. Elders, you come. Elders, come and kneel. Everybody, stretch forth your hands. Father, we ask you right now, Lord God, that every single need, Lord, we have written out the petitions. We have made them our request. Lord, this is our asking you. This is our way of asking you, O God, that you will heal, deliver financially, pour out, remove curses, every kind of disease that would be written down, all sons and daughters be saved. Father, every trial, every trouble, can't imagine, oh God, as you have read every single one of these requests, we declare, we believe that in the name of Jesus, that Lord God, not just a couple of these, but every one of these, God, this cross represents, Lord, it represents, God, what you have done, how you have died for us. God, this is our heart. This is our desire. And we believe, God, that you would do the work in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, God, in these days, in this time, in this Lent season, thank you, Lord. Thank you, you're going to do it, God. Lord, I don't know all the needs in the world, but I know every need on this cross. God, I know you're going to answer. I know. I just believe it. I pray it, God. Even up to Easter weekend, Passover, the need will be met. And everybody together, just say, in the name of Jesus, we declare. Through the name of Jesus, that every name and every need, it will be met. We believe, we know, we declare it, and in Jesus' name, it will be done. It will be done. We will give all the glory. All of the honor to you, Lord Jesus, because you answer prayer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, can we just clap our hands and thank him? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The cross is growing. Get your cameras out. 3 more Wednesday nights, I think. You can see the cross is growing and it will be filled, and we are believing. This is going to be great. Anybody got a miracle on this cross? How many miracles are on this cross? So as it goes up, let us just begin to rejoice. Let us begin to thank God. Get your cameras out. Take a picture of it. Send it to somebody. Tell them you'll pray. You want their name on the cross as it goes up in the name of Jesus.
amazing and it was really cool, and I hope they continue to do this.
I love the show, and I think it was an excellent way to getting the message out about Christ for people that never really knew the message.
Go see Jesus of Nazareth!
Son, it's in your blood.
My dad always told me that nothing can distance you from God's love. And boy, I tried.
Felt like you know the man you want to be, but you're just not strong enough? Every day.
Preacher boy.
Just trying to start over, you know?
I don't think they'll allow my good friend Jack Daniels in church.
You're beautiful, inside and out.
I've never met someone like you.
And I was certain I lost a chance to love someone as special as you.
A year ago, I was high on cocaine.
I know we don't talk about this kind of stuff in church, but I don't know why.
I was tired. I was cold.
I've been watching you since your so-called conversion.
Rock and roll.
It's an infection.
You're gonna try and tell me you've never made one mistake.
Not a one!
You're finished.
Our life was stolen from us.
Look, I'm fighting for our dream.
At the bottom of a well, I can see the light. I just can't reach it.
You're my best friend. I need you. You still love
me. I got lost somewhere along the way, but you kept loving me.
A lost cause now is found.
Never give up on the dream that God has given you.
All because of your love. You still love me.
Everybody stand up. We're going to pray for the movie. It's tomorrow night nationwide in 740 theaters. Come on, everybody, with your faith. When you see the movie, you'll see Pastor Kent's name as producer, and he is the main producer. The story is true. It's another pastor in Jeff Smith, and he's a pastor of a church in right outside of Orlando. And it's about his father and mother. It's a tremendous story. And Pastor Ken had to get all the money. He was the main one to put it all together. It is Jeff Smith's true story. So he wrote it and Jeff directed it. These are two pastors, Pastor Ken and Jeff. And then some of the other producers that you see, they're the ones that were hired to help in the cinematography and some of the other things, but really they carry load. Making a movie is a very interesting project. And I have a great appreciation for all movies that I see now because of all the effort and all of the work. So everybody together, we're standing, you're watching, standing tomorrow night. Now, if it does good, Sony is standing by and Lionsgate is standing by. So what Lionsgate did, they invested $1 million to get it into 750 theaters. So what happens is, this is an $8 million movie, and if any of you have been following the Jesus Revolution, did very well last week. It did $30 million in America. That's phenomenal. Then The Chosen is coming out. So Pastor Kent's movie was chosen by Lionsgate in this season. They needed a third movie. So they went after it, and they said, if it does well this weekend in 740 theaters, they will put another $3 million, and it'll go to 2,000 theaters. So that's what we're talking about. It's a great story. You could take anybody, if they believe in God, don't believe in God, don't like church, do like church, don't matter. It's that great of a story. And we're going to believe, and everybody say, in the name of Jesus, Lord bless this faith movie in Jesus' name. Let many people get saved, be inspired, and wake up Hollywood to let them know good movies is what we're looking for on the big screen. And everybody say, amen. Amen. Turn around, tell somebody, I'm glad you're here. Turn around, tell somebody, I'm glad you're here. Way to go, way to go. Way to go, way to go. Tonight we're talking about angels, and a week from Saturday, we start Jesus of Nazareth. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds are in the cast. We worked Monday night, we worked last night, we'll work tomorrow. And then all day Saturday, have church on the weekend. It's nonstop. There's a premiere tomorrow night with the movie. And so we are excited about all the things that God is doing. So for some of you to understand what a premiere is, a premiere, what we do, the red carpet. We have the red carpet that's in the gym. And what we do is we start earlier, like at 4 o'clock. We have a band. And we have hors d'oeuvres, and the premier VIP part is very interesting. It's just like going to the Oscars, meeting the actors and the directors, and they come in, we decorate the whole gym, and the VIPs come in, and then those that especially signed up for it, it is a very special thing. Now, why do we do this? Do we do it that we just want to really say, look what we can do, this is so cool, we are the only church in America that does something like this, the set, etc. And when people come, they say, oh, this is unbelievable, and it really is. Why do we do this? Well, the reason why we do the red carpet is because, there are some people that we want to go after who are impressed with that kind of presentation. It could be your doctor, your lawyer, it could be a politician, it could be just a regular housewife. But you yourself have the opportunity to say, we're going to show you how the kingdom of God does it. And most people, I think you all would agree with this, that most people, when you tell them this play, we usually say the word play, which is dangerous because they immediately think it's nothing but a playful thing. Then when you mention church, they kind of say, oh, it's really going to be bad. Because they do not expect the church to do anything good. Come on. I'm talking about doing stage productions, presenting with, tech and quality and microphones and animals. They do not expect that. Most people think when you invite them to a church to a production, they think it'll be bathrobes, the wings will be falling off, people will forget their lines, they'll laugh and they'll say, it was a cute little thing. But when they come here, right? How many have seen Jesus of Nazareth? How many have seen it? Now, for you that have never seen it, you need to make the big effort to see it. Because this, you say, I already saw it. I saw it 2 or 3 years ago. I saw this. You know, you may do that. That's all right. Because 80% of the audience that views this when this is sold out have never seen it. And the reason why we are doing this, so that you can get somebody to come that's never been to church, that wouldn't come to church, they wouldn't even think about coming to church, because they might be Catholic, or they might be Methodist, or they might be Baptist. They may be already a part of church, or they're into religion of some kind. And you just say, look, just come and see the greatest story of the death, burial, and resurrection. This is a great time for people who don't know anything about the gospel. And you say, come and let me sit you next to me, and we're going to get some popcorn, and we're going to have fun. And they probably wonder what in the world, and don't tell them you're coming to church. Yes, it's done in our church, but just tell them it's a production. This is a stage play. This is like Broadway. You've never seen anything like it, right? How do you talk about it? How many has never seen Jesus of Nazareth? Lift your hands. You've never seen Jesus of Nazareth. So you know what I'm talking about, right? So why do we do this? Why do we do all this work? Why all these volunteers? Why all these animals? Why all of this work? You know how much time it took for us today to set up to have church for you tonight? Then we got to tear it all down, get the curtain up, got to get everything ready for rehearsal. And then Saturday night, we got to put it all back together and have church. And people who come to church never think, man, they got it easy. They haven't done anything in the last 24 hours. And we have worked around the clock so we can keep in devout. Why do we do all of that? We do it because we want to win people to Jesus Christ. Come on, let me hear somebody. Come on. Listen, how many, give me about a minute here. How many of you are planning to go to heaven? Not very many. No, I'm kidding. How many of you are saved? Shout amen.
Amen.
God did not save you to keep your mouth shut and never talk about him, and you die and you go to heaven. In fact, that's the opposite. The reason why God saves you is because everybody here and everybody that's ever been saved said these words: Lord, I'll do anything. I'll believe, forgive me of my sins. I don't want to go to hell. Give me a brand new start. Put my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. I want to go to heaven. And the Lord said, all right, that means I got all of you. Oh, yes, Lord, whatever you want. And he said, okay, I'm going to fill you with my power so you will tell somebody else about what I did for you, and I want to save them. Hey, everybody in agreement? Come on, everybody. You want me to get some scripture verse out on you? Ye shall receive power, Acts 1 and 8. Ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses. God did not save you. If you're not witnessing, if you're not winning people to Christ, something's wrong with the God inside of you. Right? So what as a leader, as a pastor, what am I doing? Now, I don't know what other churches do. I don't know what other pastors do. I don't know what they do. What we are doing is we're doing everything we can to make it easy for you to get somebody here to see a major production who would be atheist, or even maybe be Catholic or another faith, or they're not spiritual, or they're divorced, they've never been in a church, they may have problems, or they may be super spiritual somewhere, et cetera, et cetera. But you bring them, and when the last light goes on and Jesus is resurrected, they're going to know the gospel of Jesus Christ has come to save everybody. Amen? So, what are we doing? We're lifting him up. We're getting people saved. Everybody. Everybody said, well, I can't afford for somebody else to come. Well, let me tell you, how bad do you want to get them out of hell? How bad do you want to influence? So here's the key. The key is we do all of this work. Most churches don't do this. They won't do it. It's too much work. But we do it so we can get people saved. And we get nearly 3,000 or 4,000 hands that go up a season that confess and believe in salvation. And I'm as excited about getting people saved in the kingdom of God. So everybody say, I'm so glad my church helps me become a good fisherman. Jesus says, I'm going to call all of you to be fishermen and follow me. So what we do is we give you bait, the production of Jesus. You put it on your hook and you go fishing and get people saved. Amen? So how many is excited about Jesus of Nazareth as it opens up? Tell everybody. Get everybody interested. And even if you've seen it, next year will be our 50th year. I've seen it. Man, I don't know how many times I've seen it. I don't know. I still cry. I still am amazed. And I've seen it more than anybody. And I'm in rehearsals. And I've done it for, this is our 49th year. And done it in 22 cities across America. And so, but it's great. The cross, hallelujah. There's power in the cross. Amen? Amen. Everybody say, my angel is coming this Passover. In Exodus 23, we read that the feast, which is coming up on us in a few days, is that the angel is coming. The Bible says in Exodus, the 23rd chapter, it talks about, in the 23rd verse, it talks about that the time of the feast is coming, and it says, for mine angel, let's read it together, everybody, for mine angel shall go before thee and bring thee into the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, and the Canaanites, the Hevites, and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. Now you probably say, well, what's the Amorites, what's the Hittites, what's the Perizzites, and what's the Canaanites, and what's the Hevites, and what's the Jebusites? Those are giants. And you have to go and get my book in the bookstore, but each one of these represent a problem you're going to be confronted with in life. Each one has a name. I don't have my book here to give you all the definitions of the Amorites, but one of them means fear. Another one means trafficking. Another one means no walls. And each one of these. So here's what God is saying. God is saying, I'm sending an angel. It's going to be during the Feast of Passover. And everything you're going through, that angel's going to go before thee. Anybody excited about that angel coming? He tells us in the 15th verse of the 23rd chapter, he says, thou shalt keep the feast of the unleavened bread. That is the communion. That is the Passover. Thou shalt eat the unleavened bread 7 days. And he talks about and commanded and give you the appointed time. So, he tells us when to have the Passover. This is one of the feasts. There are three feasts. These are very important to God. Has nothing to do really with us other than what he's going to do if we will respond. So God has not deviated. He hasn't stopped it. Even after Jesus died on the cross, he has not stopped the timing, the seasons, and what is about to happen. Now let me show you if I can, spiritually, what's going on. Now, Passover and Easter Sunday is a few Sundays away. Satan knows these feasts. Now, feast means, and I really encourage you, and I'm not trying to sell books. I don't need to sell books because I sell plenty of these, and many of these books have been distributed and probably nearly a million now in the last few years. Through all ministries, not just ours, the seven blessings of the Passover. They're all over the world. This is it's very easy reading. You should pull it from your library. If you already got it, study it, get it out, get your Bible, find out and recall and know the seasons. And you will study, and I've done it for you. Feast means God makes an appointment with man. And if you obey, if you respond, he makes an appointment with you. He doesn't do it with everybody. He gives you the season. He gives you the opportunity. And then when the obedience, you respond with obedience, he then makes the appointment with you. Now, at this time, every believer, he hopes, will be obedient during the Passover weekend. Now, the Passover weekend, which is this year Easter, it deviates in certain times of weeks because of the lunar calendar and the moon. So this year, it's the first week in April. Now, God has already timed that this is his season. Now, there is another force, which is Satan. Satan also knows about this season. And I'm going to show you how powerful God is and how God will not tolerate to let the devil even think that he can control God. I'm going to show you something. The end of the Passover in a few weeks, when we have Easter in a couple weeks, you will notice all churches, all religions that believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it is one of the biggest Sundays of attendance. And people just go. They buy bonnets, they buy suits. Some people don't buy anything at all. And they go to Easter. The place is filled, not just our place, but many churches have extra people come. You could tell those people on Easter Sunday, next week we're going to give you $100 if you come. Of course, that might work. But the next Sunday, it just drops off like a cliff. And I've done everything. I've been preaching a long time, so I've done everything. I have rigged it up that next week I'm going to be in an eagle's nest. Next week I'm going to fly around the auditorium like Superman. Next week I'm going to do this. Next week we're going to give this away. Trying to get the people who normally don't come back. Nothing works. Nothing. You get a certain, if you study Easter, every pastor, every church, if you talk to pastors, and most pastors usually go out of town the following Sunday because they can't take what has happened from can't get the people in to where's everybody at? Now, that's just a deal. I'm going to tell you, would you like to know something spiritually? The reason why that is because God kicks in, God pours out. It's the last day of double portion and the beginning of the former rains from Easter to atonement. We're still in the double portion. Everybody get some of it. Everybody get some of it. We're still in the double portion. From atonement to Easter. And the Lord really spoke this in my heart. He said, I want the devil to know that people come on Easter that don't even like to come and don't even know why they're there and don't even know how they got there. And if you talk to them, we'll say, well, my grandma, my mother, they got me here, so we come, my buddy come. And they really don't know what's going on, and the Spirit of God touches them, and God does all of that, and then they're oblivious, and you won't see them because their heart's not right or whatever, and you won't see them for another year. So you want me to give you a clue? I think, and know for sure, that God steps up on his feast day, which is the Passover, and makes people come. For the Bible says he's going to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. Huh? That's everybody. Atheists, everybody. Don't matter who it is. And God draws people on his feast day. It's the only, it's one of the most powerful days of the year. And it's a pattern every single time. And everybody talks about it. I believe that Satan has to back up. And God shows Satan, it's my day. It's my day.
Somebody will get it in a minute.
God says, it's my day. And I'm going to make people to come whether they like it or not. Even people that are not saved, people that even don't even like me, I'm going to draw them for one reason, to show the devil the prince and powers of the air. I can do what I want to do. I can even take your sinners that are going to hell. They're not going to get saved because they don't want to get saved. But I'm going to show you I have the power to draw them in. Huh? So, if that is, and it is factual in that area of thinking, then Satan is going ballistic at this moment. He knows exactly what God is going to do for his people. What's he going to do? Well, in Exodus, he explains very clearly, and it's very broken down in the book, Seven Blessings of Passover. He explains it very clearly. He said, I'm going to dispatch an angel. I'm going to be an enemy to your enemies. And he actually says, the angel that I send to you, now if there's two or three in your household and you're saved and you all participated, that means you got a house full of angels. They're working on your behalf. The student, the child, the mom, the dad. There may only be one believer. So you got one angel with four unbelievers. But that doesn't weaken the angel. The angel is assigned to you. The angel then goes before you and begins to take care of your enemies. Whatever you've been going through, the angel says, we're going to correct this right now. Let me tell you what else he does. This is all in the Bible. It's all in several places in the Old Testament, but especially in Exodus 23, Leviticus 23, Deuteronomy 16 chapter, you will see that this angel goes before you, and the Bible talks about that God is going to give prosperity. Now, all of you that need more money, all of you that need more money, remember God gives power to get wealth. All of you that need opportunity, all of you that want to climb the scale, this is the season in which God tells the angel, this is what I want you to do for them in the next 6 months. Of course, this angel is assigned for 12 months, so there's a tag team situation with Pentecost and atonement. But this angel, the Bible says, the Lord says, I'm going to send bread. I'm going to give prosperity. Then he does something. Would you list them for me? Would you list seven things for me? He does something very, very interesting. This is a very, and he does it in the Passover season and the atonement blessings. There's some other blessings. The atonements are not the same blessing as other blessings, but there's something here you everybody needs to hear. Number four is if you will read closely, God will take sickness away from you, but the word says, when you read it, it says, I will take sickness out of the midst of thee. This is what the word says. I will take sickness out of the midst of thee. Now here's what that means. Even if somebody is sick in your household or sick among you, that angel, Bible talks about healing in the angel's wing. The angel can't do it, but God tells the angel and he puts healing in the wing of the angel and the angel goes in and heals. You will notice, everybody, you will notice that you're dealing with body everybody is dealing with body stuff right now. Your blood, all kinds of stuff are going off in your body. You're actually being attacked by the enemy. He is doing something. We are in war. You know you're in war. Flesh and the spirit are contrary. So you have an enemy of your soul, and he's coming after you. He's trying to get you sick. He'll use the seasons. He's a trader. He's a trafficker. He's a broker. He wheels and deals against you. That's what's going on right now. Notice things are happening weird in your house, on your job. Pain. What's going on here? What's going on with this money thing? You are being set up by the enemy because he is afraid that if you believe what's getting ready to happen to you, he's got to get you in a board mentality that you will not do what God said to do. So there is a power that comes in at Passover weekend. Look at this. Gives you long life. In other words, God says, the last 10 or 12 or 20, for some of you 30 years, you have eaten wrong. Now, you don't have to admit it. I just look at you. You know you have eaten wrong. You look at me, eating wrong. I love you when you say, I don't know who he's talking about. The doctor told you you're overweight 25 pounds. Hey, you're the one I'm talking about. You have eaten wrong. You have accumulated. You've accumulated upon your body. You got a lot of sugar in it because you like sugar. I like sugar. You like flour. You know what I'm talking about. Don't get mad at me. I didn't do this to you. You ate more than you should have eaten. You've eaten more French fries than you should have eaten. You've eaten more whatever. At Passover, God sends an angel. Because you are scheduled to die, because you reap what you sow, before your appointed time. The devil's trying to kill you before your time. Do you understand that? You've been guaranteed to live to 70. The Bible talks about 60 and 10, which is 70. You've been guaranteed that. But then God wants to bless your life that you can even go beyond that. But watch this. Now, you don't have to be smart to know this. The devil has set you up for the last 25 years. Whether it's been through drinking, smoking, or eating donuts every day. You know, we always get on to somebody, they're an alcoholic. What about you, foodaholic? Oh, no, we don't talk about that. There's nothing wrong with that. No, there's nothing wrong with that. Your poor legs are screaming, please give me help. Please give me help. Your feet are screaming, please, could you just have some mercy on me? Nope, just eat. Your body is a temple. Your body is special. You need to thank me that I'm up here rattling the chain a little bit to try to say, come on, that's good. When I'm training with my body, I don't like my trainer. I don't like my trainer. I pay him, but I don't like him. He's pushing me. Five more. Shut up. I'm not doing five more. Five more. I can't do five more. I do 20 a set, and then the next couple of weeks, it's now 30 a set. Nobody likes to be pushed. Nobody likes to go and say, leave me alone. If you were left alone, no telling where you'd already be dead. Thank God there's doctors. Thank God Thank God you can go to the department store and realize I used to wear a 12, but now I wear a 26, and I need to get back down to... Let me tell you something. It's getting real quiet in here. Don't get mad at me. I'm trying to get you to live longer. I want you around. You're important. Hello. Your heart's important. Somebody amen me whether you like it or not. Just amen. This angel of Passover comes and corrects your past and can extend what normally can't be extended. This is scripture. This is not a gimmick. And God will correct and heal. Thank God it can heal what we did in the past. It can be fixed. Maybe this week, I don't know. I'll talk about Hezekiah, who God added 15 more years to his life. Well, this season, God's going to make an appointment with you. You go into obedience, and God will say to the angel, I want them to live another 5 years. They were scheduled to die 3 years from now, but I want them to live another 5 years. I want them to live another 10 years. No, they're going to live another 15 years. And it don't matter if you break your leg, get in an automobile accident. It don't matter if you fall backwards on the ladder. God's going to make up in his mind, because the Bible says it is appointed unto men once to die, and the devil has no right to give you that appointment time, but he will try to steal your life before that appointment time. That's the reason why we believe in healing. That's the reason why we believe that Jesus will heal you and deliver you. And amen. So this angel's coming to correct some things in your body for your future. This should excite you. This is nothing to say, oh, well, this is not important. Now we're going to go through Easter. Well, let me tell you, baby, your hat's not going to keep you living longer. You dressed up, it's not going to bless you. It's just going to, you're going to put on the credit card and pay for it the next 3 months. You go into a big meal and Easter eggs and all of that. That's what's going to be important is God, if you know the word, is going to dispatch an angel and things are going to happen in your life. He calls increase. There's increase. It's just increase starts happening to you. Good things start happening to you. You start selling, you start buying. You just things open up. Sale opens up. You'll be at the cash register and they'll say, they just switched it right now. What'd they switch? They just did the sale right now. In fact, you don't have to pay this retail price. You just save $5. You just save $10. And you stand there and say, and then you say, oh, yeah, that's supposed, the increase is supposed to happen to me. And then in Exodus it says, for 12 months. Now, a lot of you have never heard this. A lot of you have said, I've never been taught this. Well, let me tell you, if you're not taught, you don't know, and it doesn't happen. But everyone that is listening to me tonight, God's got something scheduled in your future that's going to be absolutely incredible. And that's what we're saying amen about. We could talk about angels, and I have several pages on angels, and they're all backed up by scriptures, and I could just go through some subtitles. Angels calls us to prosper our way, and I have Genesis. I have a scripture verse that proves that. The next subtitle is angels protect and guide us. I have a scripture verse. And then angels persist until their assignments are finished. I have a scripture verse for that. Angels can be agents of wrath against the enemy. There's a scripture verse for that. Because you can't just say something, you have to back it up with the word of God. Angels bring peace and increase faith of the believer. There's scripture verse for that. Angels can be agents of God's encouragement. There's scripture verse for that. Angels can be God's agents of war. Angels surround us and deliver us. There's a scripture verse for that. Let me just stop and just give it to you real quick. Psalm 34:7, talking about angels surround us and deliver us. The angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him and delivers them. Now, you need to know this does not automatically happen. Now, when you're born again, God writes your name, and it's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You're on your way to heaven. And let me just tell everybody, you can go to heaven broke. Busted. And almost disgusted. And just say these kinds of words. Praise God. I'm broke. But I'm going to make it. And then other people around you, they're prospering and you're going, they must not be as spiritual as me. Or they would be broke like me. Jesus came to this earth to save you, to redeem you, to make sure that you would be born again, that you would go to heaven. But he came that you might have life. And I'm going to go on a little rampage here, so you kind of help me and pray for me right now. These religious people who tell you you should not be preaching a prosperity gospel. And there's a lot of that. There are religions and people who believe in Jesus Christ that are against what I'm saying when I tell you God wants to prosper you. Don't teach it. Don't tell the people. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And I'm going to make it very, very clear. It is not right to live in a world that we live in. And especially all of you that live in America. It is not right that Hollywood, the people of the world, with their jets and their popularity and their mansions, that this generation looks at them and says, now those people have got it made. And they look at the church and say, I don't want that. The bickering and the fighting. There's more prejudice in the church. Not in this one, I hope, but because blacks are blacks. I ain't going to no white. And if there's any white in there, I'm not going. Because black matters. And then you got white people. I don't want any color in here. I like it white. Then you got Hispanics. El taco, no, you know, Padre Cristo, Señorita. Spanish. It's in every culture. It's not in one. All right? And there's so much bickering in the church that nobody, until you have these groups like the LBG, queer, whatever, lesbian, whatever, they create an atmosphere of club to accept people. And there's more love in that. And more love in the club. If that's true love. And more love in those atmospheres. Come get drunk with me. Come to mine. Come home. The church. Oh, that's boring. That's where people get into cliques and everybody fights and everybody's judging each other. The world don't want that. And neither does Jesus, because Jesus said, I've come and I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to make you, when you're born again, you believe in me. And they slaughtered me like an animal, like a lamb. And I did that for you. I took your place. I take your sins. I'm not messing around. I'm going to make you a holy nation. I'm going to make you an ambassador. I'm going to make you the head and not the tail. I want the world to see who you are. I compliment every person in here because you jump over hurdles. You don't let color affect you. You are excited about life. You don't have time to march with this issue or that issue. The only thing you have time for is to lift up the banner of Jesus. And if we're going to have a march, we're going to have a march when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, that's good. You guys are ahead of me here. So, Jesus came that you might have light. Your elevator don't have to go all the way to the top. There'll be no money in heaven. So if you are thinking, I'll pay all my bills when I get to heaven, there's no bills in heaven. There's no hospitals in heaven. There's no doctors in heaven. There's no lawyers in heaven. Hallelujah. No offense, all you lawyers. God bless you. We need every one of you. There'll be no currency. There'll be no money. There'll be no such thing as prosperity. We'll be way above that. He wants to prove something with you. To show your relatives, your neighbors, the people in town. When I do something in your life, the whole neighborhood has got to say, what is going on in your life? So the seven blessings are, the seven blessings is about prosperity. It's about healing. He wants to show you off to the point that people say, how did you get? And you just have to say it. God did it. Don't ever say this. And this is to the believer. Don't ever say, well, it was just luck. What? So that means that you bow down to dice every night and say, holy, holy, holy is seven. Holy, holy is five and six. Holy. No, you give all the glory. Don't be ashamed. God has blessed me. Look what God is doing. Oh, I'm excited. Give him all the glory. There is warfare. It's warfare with this angel that's going to be assigned to you. And Satan, He's a trafficker. Let me tell you how good he is. He doesn't have horns. He's not red. He's Satan. I'm talking about, well, we shouldn't call him Satan because thus Satan, the Bible refers to thus Satan. And Satan has several names. And some of the names that Satan has, or the word Satan, means deceiver, troublemaker, traitor, trafficker. Okay? Let me tell you who he is. It's all described in the book of Ezekiel 28. In the garden, remember the Garden of Eden, no doubt, was high enough that there was access to the heavenlies. The garden went all the way to the heavenlies. Went all the way to where God allowed the atmosphere. So it was just not on the earth. All of that came apart when sin hit and we were separated. Now, let me fast track and tell you, when the rapture takes place and when he ends the world, he's going to burn up this planet. That's in the Bible. The planet's going to burn. Let me show you. This is cool. The earth was once baptized. When was it baptized? Anybody know? When was the earth baptized? The flood. It has not got the holy fire yet. The next move end of the world, Armageddon, all of that. You go to heaven, you're in the rapture, those that don't. It's a burn up in here and a continuous burning into hell. It's just terrible. You never die. But he's going to burn up the earth. Then the Bible says he's going to make a new heaven and a new earth. Because I don't want to go into the atmosphere, but the atmospheres, we can only go so high, and God's going to create. When the new earth is made, all believers will come back here, all the way from Adam, or all the way to whatever believer, and the blood is applied, and this will become paradise. No devil, no disease. This is, I have to fast track this, but this is actually before we do the final white throne judgment and live in heaven, but actually we live on heaven and earth and we go in between. Because the earth was baptized and fire. You have to be baptized and receive the Holy Ghost fire. See, God's never deviated. Okay? So Lucifer had great reign. And when you read Ezekiel, and I'm going to read it from the NIV to let you hear what God says about him. The Lord says, and I'm going to read it in translation, King James Version. You were the seal of perfection. Here's God talking about Lucifer, and I'm going to refer to Lucifer because Satan refers to a bunch of other names, and we do refer to him as Satan or Lucifer and the devil, etc. But you were a seal. This is him. And let me say to everybody, he's exactly like this right now. Right now. You could see him. He fits this description. You were sealed of perfection because when he was thrown out of the garden and when he was cursed, because you'd have to understand that seraphim angels, look a little bit like dragons and snakes, only they can fly and they were beautified. And no doubt the seraphim demon, Lucifer, most likely was in this, and Ezekiel and Isaiah describe seraphims, and it's a little bit longer study, but you'd have to understand it. They almost look, but they're a beautified snake or a dragon. They look beautiful. I mean, but now they don't because they've been cursed and they're on their belly. So because of what they did with Adam and Eve. So you must understand that Lucifer. This is what God, and God created him, and God says, you were a seal of perfection, full of wisdom, perfect in beauty. You were in Eden. I let you hang out in Eden, in the garden of God. He's describing Lucifer. Every precious stone was your covering. Sardis, topaz, diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, the workmanship. He goes on till iniquity was found in you by the abundance of your trading. You became filled with violence within and you sinned. He goes on and says, if you read it, you find you were very talented with your pipes. You were a leader. Satan falls to the planet. Are y'all bored with this? Is everybody bored with this? Everybody? He's never changed his talent. He moves through music. He moves through fashion. He moves through. He was very expensive, one of the most expensive angels that God created. He moves through mentality of expensive, and so that has become his God. And he constantly rebels, and no one can tell him what to do. Who tells you what to do? And when they tell you what to do, will you do it? So notice that Satan is good in music. He's also good in drama, movies. That's his influence. So who owns Hollywood? Who owns influence? Look at our music. How come we buy music that has the F word? Take your clothes off. Talks about parts of the body, and have a popular woman call your children a whore and dance to it. What's that bee lady? The bee lady, she has this, she had a popular song, and yeah, Sister Cardi B. If you're watching, we love you. But she had a song that she called, all the ladies are like whores or something. Nobody said, I ain't telling you I heard a song. I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. You got me up here and you're strangling me. It's all right. Why do we slog? Because Satan is a traitor and a trafficker. So when you hear music, you have to decide, hey, this has gone too far. Click. You have to do that. There are some good love songs. And they should be played in your bedroom if you're married. I think that Barry White has got some anointing on him in some things. But you better be married. Leave Barry alone till you're married. And don't get married and try to be holy and say, we're going to have service in here while we're making love. Hallelujah. No, there's. I don't do that. I'm not going to do that. And if Melody starts talking in tongues while I'm making love to her, I'm going to say, shut up and do that at church. Let's get right to the point here. Come on, be real. You got to be real. So you have to decide. One time a lady came up to me and said, I saw you at the River Oaks Theater. And of course, they closed down now, but I always loved that theater. It was the biggest theater in this region. And she says, I joined the church because you got up halfway in a movie and walked out. I just couldn't sit there. I didn't know it was going to be like that. I had to get up and choose. I wasn't asking anybody. So you have to say, is this being pushed by demonic force? Or is this good? Everybody got me here? Quit turning on the radio and listening to everything. And that goes for me too. Because there's a lot of stuff. For instance, I got caught up with, he's short. I really like his music. I have to pick and choose. The funk guy, the guy funk? Who? Yeah, very talented. Bruno Mars. I like that guy. I had to weave in and out of his stuff. I guess, oh, well, I can't. And then, so, but he had a song, Hallelujah. He had a Hallelujah in it. I immediately thought, it's a spiritual song. Because all I cared about was a hallelujah. But when I slowed it down, pour me some liquor. Call for the limo. Jackson, Mississippi. That's all I remember. And I had to say, yeah, I can't do this. I can't get that in my spirit. I have to understand what is being driven, what I'm hearing, what I'm seeing. Everybody say a great big amen. Amen. Now, I know you got music. I got, you know, these kids, they're back there right now. And they're not kids, but the teenagers. And I know they listen to this kind of music because you could turn on something and they will dance. I mean, they just go crazy. You start singing a fast song in church and they're like this. Something got to change. We got to know when to dance, when not to dance, when to get behind, when not to get behind. Does that make sense? So let me end with this. Because Satan is really a con artist. He studies you. If there is somebody that knows you, not only God, Satan. And of course, he's not omnipresent, so he has all of a third of the angels. And you trust me, he's assigned someone to you, even though they're not in your house. Not yet. He's watching you. Okay? That's the reason why you want this angel. When God dispatches that angel says, don't you dare touch him. I could see you. I know who you are. Get back. I rebuke you. That angel has that power. Right? Let me see if I could do this in 1 minute and you play me some music. A great example of what happens at Passover was with a man named Gideon who said these words. He was in hiding in a wine press. There was so much persecution, much like Ukraine is under Russia or whatever you how you want to think. But Gideon was poor and barely making it, and the whole Israelite thing in the book of Judges was bad. And all of you can relate with this because you go through bad things with sickness, money, etc. And he was hiding. And he was a slave. You could reflect upon slave stories. He was scared to death. It came Passover time. It's exactly a Passover. And the angel, and the Bible teaches us that when angels show up, if you actually see them, they look like humans. And all of you have already bumped into angels. You don't even know it. Because it says, beware lest you entertain angels unaware. You entertain them. They're in your sword. They're everywhere. Don't go looking for them. You won't find them. But they're there. They're there. They're everywhere. And yours you may not see and no doubt won't see, but he's there to protect you. He's been given strict orders, and it comes at Passover. So now it's Passover season, and Gideon is scared, and he's in a wine press, and trees are growing over the wine press, and wine press is a big area where they put a bunch of grapes in and they squeeze them in the old day where Gideon was. So trees had grown over, and he was growing a garden there because he's trying to feed his family because they were slaves, and he was scared to death that they would even find food in this wine press. A man shows up, and Gideon freaks. The man comes up to him and says, hey, thou good and mighty man. Now listen to me. The Lord is saying about all of you, you great people, mighty people. The first thing that you and I do when we hear that, I'm not mighty, I'm poor. I don't have much. I don't have any breaks. I'm suffering. And it doesn't matter what category of wealth you're in, poor, a little bit of wealth, a lot of wealth. I am, and when this man begins to tell him, which he doesn't know it's an angel, tells him, you're a mighty man of valor. Great things are going to happen to you. And Gideon starts mouthing off saying, I'm the poorest man in Manasseh. I'm third generation poor, cursed. And then nothing happening in my life. And when I say poor, immediately some people say, that's not for me because I'm blessed. No. It's the attitude in which the angel is trying to say, something good's getting ready to happen to you. And the Bible says that he keeps talking to Gideon. Quit being negative, Gideon. Quit being negative. You're going to be a deliverer. Great things are going to happen. And it was exactly a Passover. It was actually Gideon's angel. Now we know that Gideon gives the offering at Passover because he recognizes this might be a different thing. So this creature may be, he may be, he doesn't quite know. So immediately, watch this, Gideon says, I want to bring you some food. I want to entertain you. He doesn't know it's an angel. He thinks it's a man. And the man said, I don't want any food, but if you want to do that, make it an offering. Because the only way this angel comes is when you stand before the Lord with a Passover offering. That somebody says, how do you get the angel? God don't require you to be perfect. God don't require you to have a bunch of things in your life as far as he's concerned of merits of good. He just requires, I need you to stand before me and do not stand empty-handed. This is at Passover. This is the reason why all of you in the next few weeks, you save and give a good Passover offering. Don't impress me, impress God. We'll lay it on the cross. Now watch what happens. Gideon quickly goes and gets, now you know food is hard to get, so what he's getting is very sacrificial. He goes and he gets a goat, and then he makes flour. Now this is going to take probably a day or two, and he's growing food in a covering camouflage, afraid that somebody's going to catch him trying to feed his family. So we know, if you read it, he is given a sacrificial offering. And the guy said, don't feed me. Put it on the rock. And we know that Gideon is obedient about offering. And I want to say to everybody, I'm not going to twist your arm. I'm not going to beat you in the head. I'm not going to do that. You don't want an angel? You don't want the blessings? Go buy some McDonald's hamburgers. Go buy you some sneakers. See if they work out when the doctor tells you something wrong with you. And then tell your sneakers, heal me. So the Bible says that he makes this offering, he puts it on the rock, and something happens. The Bible says the guy with the cane strikes the rock, starts a fire, and the man steps up and vanishes in the fire. And Gideon falls down and said, that's my angel. And then he starts remembering how he says, oh, I'm the poorest man, I don't have that. And the man was telling him, you're a mighty man of valor. You're going to do great things. And then God raised him up. And for you that know the story, he raised him up. And with 300 men, he took a whole nation out. And God made him very wealthy and powerful. That was all at Passover. So I want to forewarn everybody. If you're going through something, you ought to smile in the mirror and say, so he knows. Now you got to know this. There's 747,000 words in this King James Version. You got to know the devil knows this Bible better than anybody living. He knows God. He knows how God operates. He knows God when he's going to do something. And when you are actually going through something, it's a signal he knows something is about to happen in your life. I can't hear you. I'm not on the phone. So don't be stupid, believers. Don't say, I'm nothing. It never works out. Start saying with your faith, oh, this is a new season. So what I'm going through right now is getting ready to change. God is about ready to do something. The angel's coming. It's a Passover season. Oh, praise God. It's a new time. Everybody shout amen.
Amen.
Get it?
Yes.
Get it?
Yes.
So I'll emphasize it more by closing here. I'm going to fly a world in. A world. A big globe. Sunday. A big, huge world. I'm going to blow your mind on that world. That's enough said about Sunday. You don't want to miss it. You don't want to bring a friend. It'd be great. Now, watch this. You are on the verge of great things, of God blessing you with the seven blessings. And if you're not healed today, get ready. Passover is coming. Okay. Ushers, get ready. One last thing. Everybody say one last thing. Did you know, how many ever heard of the waters being troubled? How many's ever heard of that? Say, I heard of that. You know when the water was troubled? On the day of Passover. Thousands of people came to the pool of Siloam. And the Bible says, who touched it? Who touched it? An angel. And on Passover, the angel would come every year and touch that pond. And the Bible said the first one in was healed. God has never deviated. There's your angel. Your angel's getting ready to come. Are you ready for God to do great and wonderful things in your life? So tonight, as we conclude this service, we're going to be faithful. Everybody say, I'm going to be faithful. And as we give tonight, we give an offering. We give it to God. I think this is a pretty good message, right? How many learned some things tonight? So you say, God, thank you for the word. Always the offering literally seals it in your heart, and the devil can't steal it. It has the power. An offering has a power tithe in whatever you're going to give tonight. So get your phones out right now. If you are going to give by phones, you that need an envelope, get your envelope out. For you that are watching me, this is a time to be faithful, to say, God, I'm going to give offerings. And I'm so excited. They got all the air conditioners adjusted. It's going on the roof. All of that is happening in God's kingdom and God's work, and God's message is going forth. So today, ushers come down the aisle, and you're starting to give now. You can write out on the envelopes for you that do it by phone. Go on and do that. Father, we thank you right now as we are giving our faithfulness, and thank you, Lord, for what you've given us, and thank you, Lord. Here's my offering tonight. Here is my tithing. Oh God, I'm so excited about giving to you. Thank you, Lord, as I'm giving. Thank you, Lord, for those that are giving. Thank you, Lord, online. Oh God, this is a great moment. You're going to bless the people. You're going to see the people. And God, you're going to do great things for the people. After you've done it on your phone, stand up. After you've given, if the container has passed you, stand up. If you've already given, stand up. Sing this song right now. Just one time. Here we go. As people are giving, we're giving. Thank you, Lord, for the givers. Thank you, Lord, for the givers. Thank you for the givers. Thank you for the givers. Thank you for the givers.
I put my faith in Jesus. No, he's never let me down. He's faithful for a generation.
Thank you for the givers. Thank you for the givers.
So I would he fail now. He won't.
Everybody stretch your hands toward the givers. These containers, many of you have given by phone. Everybody lift your phone up. Wow, I'm so impressed. So impressed. Everybody say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm not ashamed to give. I love to give. And what I put in your hand always multiplies back to me. Thank you, Lord.
I'm so excited
about a new season, about Passover. And everybody say, in Jesus' name. Lift your right hand up. I'm going to bless you. Father, these are the people of Wednesday night and those that have looked in. These are the most incredible. God, these are not just average Christians. They make Wednesday night. They learn. They're hungry. And great things are going to happen to the Wednesday night people. And in the name of Jesus, I bless your health. I bless your mind. I bless your money. I bless in the name of Jesus. Good things are going to happen in your life. And everybody shout amen.
Amen.
Turn to somebody and say, you're blessed. You're blessed. God bless you. Well, I hope you enjoyed this word tonight. I hope you enjoyed the cross. I hope you also enjoyed the commercial of the movie. We are very excited about Pastor Kent's movie. It opens up tomorrow. And it is in theaters throughout the nation, 750 theaters, and it starts tomorrow night. See in your area, Southern Gospel, look it up, and see if it's in a theater near you. Go see it, go and support it. And so we are all excited about the movie. We're excited about this faith movie, this great story. It's going to be great. So I encourage you, everybody, I encourage you that you go see the movie Southern Gospel. And you can get on your computer, southerngospel.com, and it'll give you all the information about the nearest theater to you. We're excited about that. We're also excited about that, you know, next Wednesday night, we're going to be praying for the cast, praying for the set, put oil on it, and we start Jesus of Nazareth. Excited about that. Real excited. Friday morning prayer, I need as many of you to come. Also, Good Friday, remember, we march to Calvary. We come on the set, and we do stations to stations, 6 o'clock and 12 o'clock, 1 hour. And communion, you that come, if you come from out of town, you will be able to take communion at the cross where Jesus dies on the set of Jerusalem. You see behind me the set. You're going to come on the set. Only once a year do we allow the public to come on the set. And that's Passover, Good Friday, 6 o'clock in the morning. I hope you'll pray with me this Friday. If you can't come, turn on Facebook. Turn us on, because we'll be praying together. God, I thank you for every person that has watched. Let the miracle, let the preparation of the angel that's coming, and God, what you're getting ready to do for the people. Thank you, Lord, for their support. Thank you, God, as they have given their offering tonight. Thank you, Lord. Open the windows of heaven. Thank you, God, for your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. See you Friday. See you Sunday. It's going to be great.